Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you for tuning in tonight for another powerful service that God has prepared for you. And we're glad you're all joining us here tonight. For my introduction, we're going to go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. And the title of this introduction is, We Are Salt and Light. We are salt and light. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 says, You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It says, You are the salt of the earth. That means believers of Jesus Christ are the salt of the earth. We're the ones that bring flavor to the world around us. We're the things that people really are seeking for. What we have is what they don't know they don't need it, but what they really need is what we have to give them. It says, It is thenceforth good for nothing if it's salt that has lost its saltiness, but to be cast out and to be trodden underfoot of men. Trodden underfoot of men. Many people feel like the whole world is walking all over them. That's how they feel every day. They feel like that there's just no hope for any kind of a future. It could be because the salt has lost its taste. There's salt, they're supposed to be the salt of the world, but the salt has lost its taste. It could be because of the salt has lost its taste. Salt should add flavor. That's why people put salt on their food. Salt should add flavor. It enhances flavor of food. Salt should cast or act as a preservative. Salt should melt coldness. The coldness and indifference in this world, when the salt enters into the room, everybody should light up and warm up because salt just entered into the room. Salt should heal wounds. Salt should heal wounds. There's a lot of people are still hurting from things that have happened to them in their past, and they just can't seem to get over it. But the salt of the earth, we, the children of God, believers in Christ Jesus, we're the salt of the earth. And when we come in contact with them, it actually will heal the wounds of their past. As Christians, we should be improving the lives. We should be improving the lives of those around us. Why? Because we have the power of the Holy Spirit. We have the Word of God. We are born again. We're no longer part of the world, but we're now part of the kingdom of God. So all these positive aspects of our new life in Christ should be having an effect on the people that we meet each and every day. Then it goes on to say, Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. Jesus said, You, again, referring to the believers in Christ Jesus, you are the light of the world. In other words, we're the light in the darkness of this world. And this world is filled with darkness. A lot of people see the future as bleak. They don't see any positive perspective in their future. And why? Because the world that they live in is constantly being bombarded with negativity. It seems like no matter which way you turn, there's no let up from the bombardment of negativity. But we are the light, Jesus said. You and I, believers in Christ, we're the light unto the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. In other words, you've been high and lifted up above the things of this natural world. That's what God has done. Jesus has lifted us up to live and exist in a higher plane of existence and relativity perspective to the world. Now, verse 15 says, Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel. In other words, that's not something that people would do. Even in today's means, you wouldn't take a flashlight and stick it under a bushel. What good would the light be? If you put the light on, no one's going to get any benefit from it. But on a candlestick, you put the light on a candlestick, and it giveth light, illumination to all. it says, to all, unto all the people, to all that are in the house, your light should shine and needs to shine so everyone can get the benefit from it. As children of God, we are to let people in this world around us get the benefit of what's happened to our lives. And that is because we are now the salt of the earth, and we are the light of the world. We should light things up. We should light a room up. There should be great expectation. There should be a smile on our faces. We should have great hope and be able to share that hope with other believers, other people even people of this world, so that they can be attracted into the kingdom because we bring flavor to their world. We bring light unto their world. Let your light so shine, Jesus said, before men, that, or so that they may see, so that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So we are to be representation of Jesus Christ wherever we go. And what we should be doing is bringing what the kingdom offers versus what the world offers. And if we bring to them what the kingdom offers, love, grace, mercy, kindness, joy, happiness, blessings, all right? All these things from the kingdom, by bringing them in and bringing that offering to the people of this world, we should be a tremendous attraction to attract them to the things of God. Note, darkness cannot dispel light. I'll say that again. No matter how powerful darkness is, it cannot dispel light. But the smallest little light can dispel the greatness of darkness. They had an experiment one time in the Mojave Desert, I think it was, that 3 miles away on a hill, they lit a flashlight about the size of a quarter and shined it. And it lit up all the way 3 miles away. They could see that light in the matter of absolute total darkness, where they couldn't even see the hand in front of their face. Light dispels darkness. Darkness can't put the light out, but light can put the darkness out. And that's what we need to realize. We are the light of the world, and we make all the difference in the world as children of God. Well, praise the Lord. I hope you receive from that today. And let your light shine into people's lives. Now, it's time to give to God. Yes, praise the Lord. It's time to give to God. In Galatians chapter 6, at verse 7, it says this. Paul writing, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." So here's the law of reciprocity. Here's the law of sowing and reaping. Come in. "Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap." So whatever it is that you sow, you're going to reap because of what you sow. The sowers go out to sow the seed, all right? So whatever kind of seed you're putting in the ground, you're going to reap a harvest from that seed. Each individual seed can produce a massive harvest. It does it automatically. All you have to do is just sow the seed. Whenever you sow into the kingdom of God and are giving, whenever you sow into the kingdom of God, you should always sow from the harvest size you want. You should always sow from the harvest size you want, not from the harvest size you have. What do you mean by that, Pastor Wayne? Well, it's simple. If a farmer has 5 corn seeds and he plants them in the ground, and when it comes to harvest time, which is around August of each every year, then what happens is it stores up, there's a stock of corn, and on the corn has 3 ears, and on each ear of corn there could be as much as 500 to 200 to 500 corn kernels. Now, if he liked that harvest size this year, all right, but he decides next year, boy, that was not quite enough corn for me. I'd like to have a little bit more. If he plants the same amount of seed as he did the year before, will he get more corn? No. He's going to get the same amount of corn as he got this year. Why? Because you planted the same amount of seed, right? You planted the same amount, and so you got the harvest size you always get. But if you want a bigger harvest size, then you're going to have to plant more seed to get a bigger harvest size. It's the same exact principle works with your giving as you give to the kingdom of God. Unless you're, if you're satisfied, though, with what you're getting and how you're living and how your finances are, then there's really no reason to change it. But if you'd like to change it and make it grow and become more prosperous so that you can even actually have more to give to God to advance his kingdom, then you're going to have to sow from the harvest size that you want, not from the harvest size that you have. If your finances are presently not enough to meet all of your need, then you need to sow from the harvest size that you want. Your harvest size will increase. Your harvest size will increase as your sowing size increases. Again, it's very simple. If I want more of corn, I got to plant more corn seeds. If I like what I got already, then I don't need to plant any more corn seeds. It's that simple. And this principle of sowing and reaping is a God harvest principle that works every time. So this is how you begin to become more prosperous. You start out at one harvest size and you decide to make it a little bit more the next time, then a little bit more the next time. And what you find is that it will consistently keep growing and growing and growing, expanding, expanding, expanding. Why? Because it is a law. It is a law called the law of reciprocity. And as you sow, you shall reap. Praise the Lord. So I hope you receive from that. Let me pray over your offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you right now for the opportunity to give into the kingdom of God. And we do want, Lord, we want to sow. Help us to sow from the harvest size that we want. Help us to have faith and trust in you as you will continue to bless our giving. We thank you that you receive these offerings tonight from our heart to you, Lord, for all that you have done for us. For we are incredibly grateful to be a part of your mighty work here on earth, and also to be a part of your great kingdom, the kingdom of God. We praise you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to sing a song now and worship God. Open up your heart, stand up, praise God right wherever you're at. And we're going to see God move tonight in a mighty and powerful way. And Pastor Maryann is coming with a great word. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Glad you joined us tonight. Blessed that you joined us tonight. And tonight is a healing and victory service. So I encourage you, as I always do, get your Bible, get your notebook, get a pen, and let's just dig into the Word of God. Amen. So Holy Spirit, we just yield to you tonight. We thank you for the anointing on the Word. Jesus, you are the Word, the master of it all. And we just thank you that we have spiritual eyes to see, spiritual ears to hear what the Holy Ghost wants to reveal to us tonight through the Word. So when we're through with this service, when we're done at the end of this service here, we are at a higher level of faith than we've been before. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I want to start tonight, and let's all go over to Matthew chapter 8, and we're going to look at verse 16. Matthew chapter 8, verse 16. And here in this one verse, we read of the physical healing miracles of our Lord Jesus. Now, we know we could read these through the Gospels, but this kind of sums up the work of Jesus in this area of miracles. So here we go, Matthew 8, 16. And when evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. He healed all who were sick. He cast out demons. All right, the physical healing miracles of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, so hold on to that. Now let's go over to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to read verses 10 through 13. Later, as Jesus and his disciples were eating dinner at Matthew's house, there were many notorious swindlers there as guests. The Pharisees were indignant. Why does your teacher associate with men like this? Because the people who are well don't need a doctor. It's sick people who do, was Jesus' reply. Then he added, now go away and learn the meaning of the verse of Scripture. It isn't your sacrifices and your gifts that I want. I want you to be merciful. For I have come to urge sinners, not the self-righteous, back to God. All right. I want us to focus in on verse 12. All right. Jesus' own words. What does he say? Because people who are well don't need a doctor. It's the sick people who do. Now, when you read that for face value, it looks like he's talking about physical sickness, right? Those with spirits of infirmity, those that are physically sick. But then he continues. He says, now go away and learn the meaning of the verse of Scripture. Now, I just put myself in the atmosphere that existed that time. He's looking at the Pharisees. Now, did he say, now go away and go study and learn what these scriptures mean? Or did he say it, now go away, all right? Go away. What was he really portraying to them? He was expressing the fact, you think you know it all. You don't know what you're talking about here. You're not understanding, because Jesus was not centering attention on physical health. He wasn't. He was centering his attention on spiritual health. And he knew. You should know better. You're the teachers of the law. You're the ones that should know better and be teaching more intuitively according to the Spirit. So what's interesting to know, Jesus is dealing, we got to keep this in mind, he's dealing with the Pharisees. And again, the ones that knew the law. But notice the rebuke. He's rebuking them. See, this was the standard charge from the rabbis to their disciples. It's what the rabbis would say to their own disciples, their own students of the law. Now go and study. All right, I'm sure they didn't say it with an attitude, and I'm sure Jesus didn't say it with an attitude. But I'm sure, like, his emotions, because, you know, he kept his emotions under control, like we all should do by the power of the Holy Ghost. But it was a rebuke. We got to keep, if there's anything we see here, it was a rebuke. He was actually dealing a double rebuke to these Pharisees. Again, this is what they would say. The rabbis would say this to their own students. Now go and study. Go study, students of the law. Jesus not only was rebuking them, it was a double rebuke. First, treating them, the teachers of the law, he's treating them as learners rather than the teachers. He's treating them as learners rather than the teachers. And then as beginners who had not yet learned Scripture correctly. There's a double rebuke here. Now, I want to go back and I want to reread the verses again. Because as we reread them, and now with a better understanding that Jesus was not dealing with physical sickness, he was not dealing with physical infirmity, physical symptoms, he shifted from physical healing. We see that through the Gospels. He did heal the sick. All that came to him were healed. But he's shifting now to spiritual restoration. That's what those verses are all about, spiritual restoration. Matthew 9, verses 10 through 13, reading them again. Keep in mind now, spiritual restoration. Later, as his disciples and he were eating dinner at Matthew's house, there were many notorious swindlers as guests there. And the Pharisees were indignant. Why does your teacher associate with men like that? Because people who are well don't need a doctor. It's the sick people who do, was Jesus' reply. And he added, now go away and learn the meaning of this verse of Scripture. It isn't your sacrifices and your gifts I want. I want you to be merciful, for I have come to urge sinners, not the self-righteous, back to God. All right, so let's ask this question. We see that spiritual restoration, sick souls, we can say it that way. Let's ask this question. How does the great physician, all right, Almighty God, how does the great physician deal with humanity's spiritual sickness and disease? Think about it. Think about it. I'm going to ask you the question again. How does the great physician deal with humanity's spiritual sickness and disease? Well, what he does, he lays humanity on the examination table. Keep the parallel as we go forward now. If you're going for your yearly checkup, you're going to the doctors to, you know, get checked and this and that. Keep that picture in mind, what happens to you when you enter into a doctor's office. He lays humanity on the examination table. He looks humanity, he looks at the throat of humanity, and here's what he says. Their throat is an open tomb. Their talk is foul and filthy, like the stench from an open grave. Wow, that's Romans 3:13, King James and Living Bible. And then what he does, he examines humanity's tongue. And here's what he exclaims. With their tongues, they have practiced deceit. Their tongues are loaded with lies. Same verse. I'm reading it from the New King James and the Living Bible. All right, humanity's tongue. Their tongues have practiced deceit. Their tongues are loaded with lies. Then what does he do? He pulls back the lips. He looks under the lips and he says, the poison of asps is under their lips. That's the New King James. The Living Bible says it this way. Everything they say has in it the sting and the poison of deadly snakes. He takes another look. Now he takes a look into the mouth of man and he declares, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Romans 3:14. Then he looks into humanity's eyes. He looks into their eyes and this is what he observes. There's no fear of God before their eyes. Romans 3:14. Then he looks at the feet. I mean, this is total examination here. And then he looks at the feet of humanity, and here's what he remarks. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Romans 3:15. Then he takes out the master stethoscope, and he listens intently to the heartbeat of humanity. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Jeremiah 17:9. Well, what does a doctor do after he does an examination, a thorough examination? He gives a diagnosis, right? Well, God, in all the examination of the body parts of humanity, this is his final diagnosis. Man is extremely sick and needs a miracle cure. Man is extremely sick and needs a miracle cure. And in the final evaluation, here's his final evaluation. The reasoning is humanity is separated from the Father's love. Humanity is separated from God. That's Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have separated you from God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. He will not hear. Now, what is that birth? What is that birth? Well, we understand sin births death. Sin brings forth death. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. He also sees and he exclaims, sin is incurable by human means. You can't go to a medical doctor, a medical professional, and say, I'm spiritually sick, heal me. No, because sin is incurable by human means. Proverbs 20, verse 9, this is the Living Bible. Who can ever say, I have cleansed my heart and I am sinless? Now the physician's concern, because God is a God of agape love. He's seen the condition of man. He's seen the condition of humanity. He's given his evaluation. He's given his diagnosis. And he's concerned because God is love. And what steps up to the plate is the mercy of God. Psalm 86, verse 15, the Living Bible. But you are merciful and gentle, Lord, slow in getting angry, full of constant loving kindness and of truth. His mercy, his concern. And his concern, Christ's death. 1 Peter 3:18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. And then what? Invitation is given. I'm concerned. Mercy, my love for humanity. And what does he do in his prescription? He's writing out a prescription. He gives an invitation. Matthew 11, verses 28 to 30. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I'm gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And then he gives an alert. He gives an invitation. And it's like a red light now flashing. Alert, alert. Conviction by the word. I'm giving you the invitation. I can't force you. I knock at the door of your heart. But here's the alert now. Conviction by the word of God. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is living, is powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Conviction by the word. The word will convict. Think about it. You don't have to go around convicting people. You shouldn't do that. You shouldn't say that. No, when God gives you the open door, just give him the word. The word is strong enough to convict man of sin. And then you got the conviction of the Holy Spirit, John 16:8. And when he has come, speaking of the Holy Spirit, when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Something very important to see there. The Holy Spirit convicts of sin. And what is that sin? Well, you did this and you did that and you did this and you didn't do that. No, the Holy Spirit convicts of sin, and that sin falls under one umbrella, the rejection of Jesus Christ. The rejection of Jesus Christ. So we see conviction by the word, conviction by the Spirit, right? This is the alert. This is the red light flashing. And then conviction by preaching. 1 Corinthians 1:21. For God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never find God through human brilliance. And then he stepped in and saved all who believed his message, which the world calls foolish and silly. Now think about that. Conviction by preaching. You know, Pastor Wayne and I come up here every service and we feed you the word of God. We preach to you the word of God. The word of God convicts, and by the Holy Spirit, conviction flows, knocks at the door. The rejection of Christ, the rejection of the word, and the conviction of the preaching. You can come into a service or you can be watching virtually online. It's like, well, I don't agree with that. I don't agree with that. I don't agree with what you just preached. I don't agree with that. Well, everything we preach, line it up with the word of God. So if there's a problem with something you hear preached, as long as we're preaching the word, you got to take it up with God. I always say it this way. Put it on a shelf. Leave it on the shelf. And don't bury it. Just say, Father, right now I'm having a little bit difficult time understanding that. But I'm not going to criticize it. I'm not going to judge it. I'm putting it on the shelf. And if that's your word speaking to me, because sometimes we reject something because we don't want to hear it. We don't want to change. So if you come face to face with something like that, put it on the shelf. Don't get aggravated. Don't get, you know, ugly about it. And just say, Lord, if that's you speaking to me, confirm it. You know what ends up happening? The next day you're driving to work, on the radio, you hear the same thing. What do you say? Satan, get behind me. No, that's the Holy Spirit showing you that word was for you. You get in work, right? Now you're kind of aggravated, like, you know what? I still don't accept that. I still don't receive that. And then comes brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so who knows you're a Christian and they're a Christian. It's like, good morning. You know what I read last night in the Bible? And they tell you the same exact thing that you heard sitting in the sanctuary or watching virtually that you rejected, put it on the shelf. See, now the choice is yours. Now you could still fight God, or you could say, you know what? Maybe that's something I better take down off the shelf and re-digest. Chew it and digest it, because God is speaking to me. Conviction by preaching. All right, so then what we see? God, still in that examination room, going to give you a prescription again. All right, conviction came, red light, conviction came. Well, now I'm going to try this prescription one more time. 1 Peter 2:24, healing by the stripes of Jesus, who bore his sins on his own body on a tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, whose stripes you were healed. Now, this is what's so good about this 1 Peter 2:24, because it's not only many times we take that just for physical healing by his stripes. Right, you study it out. We've taught this before. Jesus bore on his back 39 stripes. If you study medical history, 39 major diseases that are known to man, and every other disease stems off those 39, not by accident. 39 stripes our Lord and Savior bore. But yes, it's for physical healing. But look at the beginning of the verse. Who himself bore our sins, his sins, our sins, on his own body. This is where the spiritual aspect and the physical aspect come together. We're talking about spiritual restoration of the soul, healing of the soul, healing of the sick soul, who bore our sins, that we died to sin, might live for righteousness, live the right way, by whose stripes we were healed, physically, mentally, emotionally, socially, financially. Total restoration in Jesus' precious blood. Healing by the blood of Jesus. Revelation 1:5. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler over all the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his blood. Again, transferring us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Total healing, restoration of the soul. Healing by repentance and faith. Acts 20:21. Testifying to Jews and also to Greeks, repentance towards God, faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. John 1:12, but as many received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. Healing through repentance, healing through faith. Examination room. God examining humanity. Putting out the alerts, giving the prescriptions, bringing conviction, bringing prescription, giving us remedy. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish. God taught us that none perish. He loves the world. He loved, he loves, and he will always love the world. And he's giving everything we ever need. The heart of the Father, Jesus' love, and giving his own life, and the Holy Spirit who reveals all of this to us day by day as we grow from faith to faith. Well, tonight is the healing and victory service. And you could say, well, Pastor Maryann, I'm listening tonight because I need healing in my physical body. Well, we're going to pray for that. But God wanted to show a different aspect tonight. He wanted to show something to us again. If you did not hear Sunday's message, the heart for the lost, how to lead your family and friends to the Lord, God's heart is restoration. And that battle is in the mind. You're going to hear a little bit about that Sunday in the opening message. The battle is in the mind. We have the opportunity, as humanity is laid on the examination table. How does this apply to us? You may be watching and thinking, how does this have to do with healing? What does this have to do with the healing and victory service? I'm already a restored soul. I already have connection with God. My spirit man has been recreated. The old has passed away. I'm brand new. I don't need to hear a message like this. Well, you know what? If that was your thoughts tonight, you're the one that really needs to hear this message tonight. And I'll tell you why. It's showing you don't have the heartbeat for humanity. You don't have that heart to see the lost come to Christ. When there's so many people in this hour that are suffering and in fear and needing to be restored, restored in their minds with peace and joy. We are the hands and the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are the body of Christ. And no matter what we may be going through right now, what circumstances and situations, when we take our eyes off of us, and we take our eyes off our circumstance and situation, and we look at the heart of God, and we wake up in the morning and say, what do you want me to do today? Where do you want me to go? See, that's seeking first the kingdom of God spending time first in the morning and worshiping God, getting into the Word, picking up your hands and singing unto the Lord, getting into His presence, worshiping Him, thanking Him, seeking first the kingdom. And that kingdom includes this lost and dying world. How does this apply to me? Let's go back to Matthew 9:12. Because people who are well don't need a doctor. It's sick people that do, was Jesus' reply. And then he added, now go away and learn the meaning of the verse. I believe tonight we've learned the meaning of this verse. We've learned to better understand, greater revelation of what this verse really means. Because Jesus was speaking in terms of spiritual restoration. Let's remember, everything in the natural first begins in the spiritual realm. And as we lead the lost to Christ, physical, emotional, social, financial healing will always come. Do you know how many times I prayed with different people that didn't know the Lord and prayed with them, and they just look and they go, I just feel better. I feel like something lifted off of me. Well, see, that oppression, many times this fear, discouragement, depression, when that's lifted, because now they come into the kingdom of God, all of a sudden their physical body starts feeling better. It's like, I just feel better day by day. I'm feeling better and better. Why? Because the joy of the Lord, the joy of our salvation is our strength, and that strength heals. That strength brings joy. That strength brings peace. That strength brings victory. So as we lead them to the Lord, physical healing will follow. As one accepts Christ as personal Lord and Savior, the rest just flows. All right, so we see from this perspective, 1 John 4:17, as He is, so are we in this world. As He is, so are we in this world. Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father. And guess what? We're seated with Him in a heavenly place. That's speaking of authority. We're seated in the heavenly place at the right hand of the Father. Seated in heavenly places in Him. He's at the right hand of the Father. We're in Him. Speaking of our authority. And in that seat of the authority, we have invested authority. We have the keys to the kingdom. How many of us don't even understand we have those keys? Matthew 16:19, and I will give you, who's he talking to? He's talking to the believer. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven, right? He's given us authority. Authority. We have the authority to loose the strongholds holding lost souls in bondage. What do we do so many times? Like, look at them. Look at their life. Oy. Well, they deserve. Look where they are. They're lazy. They don't want to work. They deserve what they get. No, how about we change our heart? Yeah, there are lazy people. What does the word say? You don't work, you don't eat. There are people that just are lazy. But they're among those that are willfully lazy. There are those that are suffering. There are those that just don't have. They don't understand. We have the power to bind and loose, to loose the enemy's stronghold off their minds, to loose the enemy's stronghold off their wills, to loose the enemy off their lives so they can spiritually see that God has a world out here of blessing. You know, so many times you hear people say, well, I was born on the wrong side of the track. Well, what about the people on the other side saying the same thing? So what side of the track is right? Huh? Here's the key. We as children of God, when we get saved, there is no reason why we cannot excel in this world's system. Once we become to understand better who we are in Christ, we have every opportunity to excel in every area of life as a child of God. And the multitude of lost souls need to come to understand that. Instead of crying and protesting and picketing and moaning and groaning, we need to intercede for them and show them there's a better way. That way is transfer out of that kingdom that's not working for you. How good is it working for you? And come on over into the kingdom of light where we have every covenant blessing that God Almighty has given us as children of His love. The authority to loose strongholds, holding these lost souls in bondage, allowing them to exercise their free wills to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Listen to that again. We have the authority to loose the strongholds holding these souls in bondage, allowing them then to exercise free will to receive Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. And then allowing the great physician to do whatever he needs to do in their lives, in their families, in every aspect of their lives. So here's the question I'm going to leave you with tonight. Are you, child of God, ready to become the great physician's surgical, spiritual assistant? Selah. Think about it. Praise the Lord. Pastor Wayne.
Amen. As children of God, we really are called to not only save souls, that's primary number one, but the second thing after that is for redemption covers poverty, sickness, and spiritual death. So that means many people are suffering physically, and God wants to deliver them from the power of what sin, the ravages of sin, has done in their life. And for someone in the world, and even sometimes some cases, some Christians that are not well versed in the word and really have not been taught about redemption, Satan locks on their door and they open the door and let him right in. And so consequently, God wants us to go out and to deliver the power of God to deliver people from the ravages of what sin is doing in the world and in people's personal lives. And that's what Jesus came for, to finally break the bond and the prison that we were all in so that we could be free to live a wonderful and blessed life. And there are a lot of people that are really suffering because of, I look at it this way, it's almost like Jesus knocks on the door of our heart to introduce himself to us so that we could receive him as Savior, all right? And so sometimes what ends up happening is, okay, well, now I'm saved, I don't need Jesus no more, so I'll just go live the rest of my life. Well, the fact of the matter is, no, you need the Lord each and every day of your life, each and every minute of your life, because sin is still the ravaging ruler of this world. And so many people are caught up in it, and sickness and disease is a byproduct of what sin does in people's lives. And the power of God is on the believer to deliver people from poverty, sickness, and spiritual death. Praise the Lord.
You know, another thing too that I see as I'm teaching this, the question that I'm leaving with, are you ready to be the great physician's spiritual surgical assistant?
Right.
And you think about when we get to heaven, right? People uh-huh. graduate to heaven. And Jesus, the multitudes of people over time that have, you know, graduated to heaven. And it makes you wonder, like, yeah. How does he go around and greet everybody and talk, you know, there's that one song, what will I do when I see Jesus? Will I fall at his feet? Well, you know, yeah. I can imagine that song. Right. I can only imagine. And you just think about it, to see him, even in a crowd, and just pass by like, look, there's Jesus over there. Right. I wonder if he's going to see me.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, he's God.
Yeah.
You know he's going to see you. But it's like our mind is so finite that's the pictures that I always get.
That's
like
really
me and Pastor Wayne will be up there and it's like, oh, I'll meet you up there when we're like 120 years old if the rapture doesn't happen before then. And it's like, oh, Wayne, like, remember me? All right. And it's like, look, there he is. He's over there. Like, let's run. Let's go see if he says hello.
Yeah.
I mean, that sounds so corny, so crazy. But here, we have the opportunity here on planet Earth to be his assistant.
Amen.
You think about a surgeon.
Amen.
And he's in the operating room and he's covered with all his, you know, garb that he's keeping
Amen.
Himself pure, and, you know, not to spread germs. And then he's got the surgical assistant and the nurses. And you would have the opportunity to work right next to that surgeon.
Amen. And the reason why we can do it is because of the Spirit of Christ within us that enables us to do what Christ is asking us to do.
That's the picture. So you take that natural picture and you bring it into the spiritual realm. We have the opportunity
Amen.
To work right with him.
Amen.
And we take it for granted and we miss those opportunities that when somebody's hurting or God says, call
yeah.
so-and-so, call them
yeah.
tonight or pray for them.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, I'll do it later. No. What would the surgeon, if he's operating on somebody and his cell phone goes off and it's like, oh, wait, excuse me, I hope you don't bleed to death, but I got to get this call,
yeah.
all right?
Yeah.
Or you're next to the surgeon and it's like, okay, you know what? Oh, look, it's lunchtime. I'll be back in about an hour.
Yeah.
Is that what we do to God?
It's,
you know, it's like, I can't do it right now, God. I know that person needs prayer and I'll pray better later. We are spiritual assistants to
true.
The great physician.
True.
And we take these things for granted. And it's like God's saying,
yeah.
wake up, people,
yeah.
wake up.
And that's what the Holy Spirit's all about. He's the phone call.
Right.
Basically, he's basically
yeah.
saying, now, call so-and-so, you know, who bring the picture of that person to your mind.
Right.
Well, that's not for you to say, oh, yeah, I wonder what they're doing. No, it's for you to call them right then, right there, right now. Because they obviously need somebody. Or if they're not able to be able to, sometimes it's not a matter of contacting them by phone, but it's intercession and prayer. Because intercession and prayer will tear down the walls and destroy the yoke and remove the burden off their life so that they can receive a miraculous power of God. So sometimes we can't do communication by natural means, but we certainly, most certainly can intercede in prayer, and it has tremendous power available through it.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, Pastor Wayne, I believe there's people watching tonight, wherever you
Amen.
Are, if it's tonight or you're watching on the rerun of this teaching, this service, and God is knocking at your door.
He is.
And you, through this message tonight, feel like you've been placed on that examination table. And the good news is this great physician wants to see you well,
yes.
wants to see you
yes.
healed
yes.
spiritually,
yes.
restored, and then
Amen.
Physically and financially and all the aspects that we talked about tonight.
Yes.
So we're going to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior
yes.
tonight.
Yes.
And you will never, ever regret this decision.
Amen.
So, Pastor Wayne,
Amen.
How about you pray?
Amen. So, if it's time for you to receive the Lord, so just simply believe what you're about to say. Believe it in your heart that Jesus is your Savior. And repeat these words after us. Say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
I believe.
That Jesus Christ.
Is the Savior of the world.
Is the Savior of the world.
He died in my place. He went to hell in my place. He arose from the dead. And ascended into heaven. Lord.
Forgive me.
For all my sin. I want to live a life for you. I receive you, Jesus. As my Savior.
This very night.
In Jesus' name. Amen. Today you're a saved child of God.
Amen.
And you have a right and a privilege to have all the blessings that any child of God has a right to. And that is, one of those things is for divine health and wholeness. And if that's you tonight and you need divine health and wholeness, then we're going to send the word. The Bible says that we can speak the word of God and send it right into your living room, right into your bedroom, wherever you're listening or watching this particular broadcast, and touch your body. It will touch, the power of God will touch your body and you will receive it. So close your eyes. And as you close your eyes, put your hand right on your body. And as you listen to this, and just receive. We'll do the praying and we'll do the sending. And you just receive what God is about to do.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So Heavenly Father, we stand in agreement right now in the name of Jesus. There are people out there, children of God and people who have not received Christ, whatever the case might be, that definitely need the touch of your holy power, the touch of the Holy Spirit, like Christ would be laying hands on them right tonight. We speak the word of God and we send the word of God. Jesus took our infirmities, bore our sickness, our pain, our sorrow, and it's by his stripes that we were healed. Therefore, we send the word right now into each and touching each and every one of these people who are reaching out to you at this very moment. And we thank you, Father God, for your divine healing. From the top of their head, they begin to feel the anointing begin to flow from their top of their head straight down through their body, Lord God, as it drives out the pain, the affliction, the maladies of whatever might be, and completely, totally restores them this very night in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for what you have done here tonight in salvation and healing for these people. We praise you this in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. I just feel there's someone watching and you have pain. It's like your right shoulder, in your right shoulder. We just thank you, Father God, that this
Jesus
word tonight, that spirit
name.
Of infirmity,
Jesus
that
name.
Pain is loosed off
Jesus
your body
name.
In the name of Jesus, and the fire of God flow
yes.
in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Pastor Wayne, let's just keep praying because I just feel like God wants to just to expose some things here. Somebody else is having pain in your neck. It's like tension in your neck. Mm-hmm. We just pray right now, the peace of God.
Yes.
Is something that you're just stressed out about, something that's really just been bothering you or the enemy's using to steal your peace and your joy. You just put your hand right on your neck right
Jesus
now. We
name.
Pray the healing
Jesus
fire
name.
Of God.
Thank you,
the
Lord.
The fire of God. Totally restore, the muscles and the nerves in that
Jesus
part of the body.
Name.
Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus' name.
Glory
back pain.
You.
Some people are suffering back pain or even lower back pain. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we send the word of God into their back, into their vertebrae, or it might even be a muscle that's twisted out of joint. In the name of Jesus, we command the healing anointing, the power and the heat of God's power go into those muscles and into those ligaments and those bones and cartilage, and we command that body to be healed right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Amen. And one more thing is the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And I just feel that there's someone watching and you've been praying for that and just asking God, you want to be baptized with the Holy Spirit and you haven't seen the manifestation of that. So we're going to pray right now. So put your hand right on your belly. Or you may be watching tonight. You've never been baptized
Jesus
in the Holy
name.
Ghost, which is a second experience.
Jesus
you have the Holy
name.
Ghost come to live on the inside of you when you receive Christ. But it's the anointing,
yes.
Who is the Holy Ghost, rises up out of you, flows
yes.
out of you, baptizes you in the Holy Ghost with the
yes.
manifestation of speaking in tongues.
Yes.
So we pray right now. You want to pray for the
Jesus
baptism
name.
Of the Holy Ghost.
Father, we thank you right now that, Father, by the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the name of his mighty name, we pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit right now to go through these airways and into the person's body right now as they put their hands up and ready to receive, Lord God. Let your holy anointing touch them right now in a mighty, powerful way. Let the power of God, the fire of the Holy Spirit, touch them as they did on Pentecost, Lord God, when 120 went down and out in the anointing of the Holy Spirit and a mighty fire of God shone upon their hearts and minds and above their heads in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the manifestation of that baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're speaking in tongues in Jesus' name. Yes, right now, There are many of you that are opening your mouth up and you're speaking sound, but the sound is forming words in the name of Jesus. It requires you to move your vocal cords, make sound, and move your lips. And God will form the words for a mighty, holy anointing to touch your body. And you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking a heavenly language that will tremendously change the course of your life. In the name of Jesus, we pray this right now. As people are receiving this out there, as they're watching this show tonight, they're receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit right in their own living rooms, right in their own bedrooms. God is touching them in the name of Jesus, we pray. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Somebody
yes,
that's
Lord.
Watching and you sense that, you feel that that bubbling coming up, just release that, as Pastor Wayne just said. But what's hindering is that you've been taught or you've heard that's not for today, that passed away with the disciples. That is error. That's not for you to believe as truth. All right? It's a second experience in salvation.
Yes.
And if you need understanding, you need teaching on that to clarify that. Call us. Call
Jesus
the number on the
name.
Screen. Call us.
Jesus
we have
name.
Books. We have pamphlets. We'll send you to give you the better understanding, which we can't teach you right now. Yeah. Better understanding to see that gift has not passed away with the disciples.
In
it's
the
in
name
the book of,
Jesus. Of
Acts. Joel prophesied that in the last days, the Spirit be poured out upon all flesh. You'd be praying in the Spirit, speaking in tongues. Call so we can help you get clarity and dispel the untruth that gift has passed away.
Amen.
Amen.
It's a heavenly language that God wants you to have. Praise the Lord. Glory to God.
Well, Pastor Wayne, another fine night.
It certainly was.
Glory to God. Praise the Lord.
Praise
we
the Lord.
Love you guys.
We do.
We're
very
here.
Much.
Prayers, anything you need, give the church a call. If you're able to come out on the Sundays, come on out. We just can sense the anointing growing stronger
Amen.
And stronger,
Amen.
Service by service.
Yes,
so
yes.
join us here physically if you can.
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. God bless you all. We love you very much. Bye-bye.